I'm Bruce A. Parra, and this is Frank J. Rich, and you're watching Frank Talks with Bruce the Blog. Frank Talks with Bruce the Blog is brought to you by Chase Media Group, which brings you multimedia marketing. Yes, that's right. I was right the first time. Multimedia marketing solutions for an omnichannel marketplace. And we like to bring you also on the show interesting people who are making very positive, influential contributions to the community. You can see all of the Frank Talks with Bruce the Blog shows online on YouTube by searching on YouTube for TownLink TV, and you'll see all the past shows from the last couple of years. And we always like to thank our CEO, Carly Chase, and my co-host, Frank J. Rich, for bringing you the show and for allowing us to bring you a lot of interesting people, including our guest right now, Bob Giordano, who has a lot of things that he does and does make a lot of contributions to the community. He happens to live in Yorktown. And Bob is the founder of the newly minted Yorktown Small Business Association, otherwise known as the YSBA. And by the way, didn't the Village People do a song, YSBA?
Yes, I think that's right.
They played at Yankee Stadium all the time.
It did play a little role in the name.
Oh, did it? Really?
Okay, I wanted something that was
resonated,
memorable.
That resonated.
The YSBA resonates and it's memorable.
Right. And of course, you know, on a serious note, SBA does stand for Small Business Administration.
Correct.
So let's talk, Bob, about why you created the Yorktown Small Business Association, why you felt there was a need for it.
Well, basically, I have a fairly extensive experience in the community, and I was one of the founding members of the Yorktown Chamber, that is the group that got it going again in the mid-90s. So I have a lot of experience with large, small, medium-sized businesses, and one of the things going through the planning board membership and members of other organizations, we discovered that local small businesses really are the lifeblood of a community, and they tend to have people who live in the community, the people who work there also live in the community, and they give back more to the community. And I personally found that they're struggling, as a lot of businesses are, and they really don't have a voice at the table. And so as I spoke to them, I found that there's a need there that's not being filled by the government in the town, by other organizations. And so we did an exploratory in the fall and said, it looks like it's a good thing. And so we formed the corporation in January, and we're on a roll ever since.
Right. And of course, because of the nature of the so-called new economy and the evolution of retailing, you and your, I guess, present and prospective members, they feel that there are more challenges than ever, right?
Correct. One of the driving factors, I was a part of the Smart Growth board, and I'm still a member of Smart Growth, and they've been very active and outspoken in reference to the development in the town, all around the town, but more specifically the Costco State Land 202 proposed developments. And what we've learned there, what I've personally learned, and the YSBA and its members are that we see that that's going to bring it's going to bring opportunity, it's going to bring jobs, and but it's also going to bring competition.
Sure.
So one of our themes is in the event that you're one of the small businesses that isn't out there on a daily basis, some of them don't even read the Examiner or the Yorktown News and may not look at TownLink and really be current on what's going on, they need help, and some of them don't know they need help. And so we decided part of our mission is going to let's knock on their door and tell them what's coming if they don't know, and if you do know, what are you doing about it?
Right, and we should mention, because this show is seen throughout Northern Westchester, so we don't want to leave anybody out in terms of what's going on in the town of Yorktown. Costco is supposed to be coming in the next, I don't know, 12 to 15 months, I would think, and that would be Route 202, which is right off the Taconic, the location of the plant Costco.
Correct.
Is right off the Taconic Parkway, just north of the Croton Reservoir, just so people can locate
right.
where we're talking about.
Right.
And we also should mention, because you did mention it, that townlink.com is a new website that Chase Media Group is launching that has 10,000, that's right, 10,000 business listings, blogs, community calendar, and we're going to be letting people know more and more about that in the coming weeks. But now the next logical question, Bob, which I think you're used to getting and responding to, is, as you said, you were part of revivifying the Yorktown Chamber in the mid-90s. And so what do you feel the Chamber is doing or isn't doing that calls for this kind of an organization to emerge?
Well, we took a look at, and I'm not a numbers guy, but I like to get my facts straight. And when we looked at, for instance, you can go to the Chamber website and see who the members are and how many there are. You can touch base with some of the business network international groups, because there's many business groups, as well as the Westchester County Association
yeah.
and
Business
Council of Westchester. So when you start looking at businesses, it lends itself to ask the question, how many are there and what kind are there and who are members of this versus that? So we did a quick review of what was out there, and we concluded that there's probably anywhere from 1,200 to 1,500 businesses operating out of Yorktown. Some are under the radar. I give you a good example. You know Barry Levin.
Sure.
I mean, a lot of businesses operate out of their home.
Yes.
My business has been operating out of the two businesses that I've worked for the last 15 years. I've operated out of my home with a little stint in a technology, high-tech startup incubator down in White Plains. So it's hard to put your finger on that. So
right.
Somebody said to me, how many businesses are there? And they said, well, you should go to the Chamber. I said, well, that's going to give you their members. Well, you should go to the town. And, they could tell you that the Underhill Shopping Center is owned by
right.
so-and-so or a group of people, but they can't give you the businesses that operate out of there.
Right.
So that, that right. was a...
And there's no reason a business can't belong to both, right?
Right, exactly. So, and that, yeah. that came up recently
right.
in a discussion, and somebody said, well, do we have to quit this organization to be a member of that? And as a matter of fact, they said, no, many businesses want to be, if they feel it's going to give them something in return for their money, a value to them, then why wouldn't you join?
Which is,
join
which reminds me, I know it was Frank,
two businesses.
Will bring this up, and justifiably so, that, the number one question, right, that's asked of community-based business associations is what am I getting for my money?
Right, mm-hmm. right. right. Yeah. So
that's a national survey question.
Right.
It's the number one question that the association members ask.
Right. So we started off as a grassroots group, and our membership fees currently are $25 for a business that is not not for profit. For instance, your Support Connections, your Alliance for Safe Kids, any civic member, that's $25. And if you're a for-profit business, you're going to have to be a small business, which I won't go into the definition, but because the definition changes. But it's not a CVS, it's not an AMP, it's not a Kmart, it's not a Costco,
so
it's not a BJ's.
They for argument's sake, came to you and wanted to join, you would say?
We would say, no, you don't reach the criteria. And right, SBA has a criteria that's based on their loan programs and other things that they're trying to accomplish. So even the Small Business Administration has different definitions depending on what you're trying to do with them or for them.
Right.
So sufficient to say that not every business in town, most of them are qualified as small businesses, but not everyone. So that, I think one of your questions, that leads you to the big box national retail definitions, and we all know who they are. I mean, you right. don't see an A&P, you don't see a Sears, you don't see a Kmart or a Walmart. You don't see them joining, for the most part, local business organizations. And
well, they join chambers of commerce.
Not always. If you really look
not
at the
much.
Numbers,
not much.
Yeah, not very much. And the way I explain it is, if I want to help a support connection or a community do-good organization, and I go to the, and I did, I went to the A&P, not that I'm picking on the A&P, I'm not, I shop there, so. But if I want a donation because we're having a barbecue, which is a fundraiser, that store manager is very limited in what he can help me with. He might go over to the bread department and give me 3 dozen, hamburger rolls, all right? Anything beyond that, he's got to make a phone call to a region or a headquarters. Right? If you go to, I won't mention a local business, but go to one of our local businesses who continuously give and say, we're having a silent auction, and suddenly an appliance shows up or somebody gives you a gift certificate for $100, there's no phone call to be made to do that.
Yeah. It's a local, local level of authorization.
Exactly.
You're not going through red tape.
Exactly.
So, Bob, if I could interrupt you for a moment. So if we could talk just for a moment about what it is that the YSBA actually does for small businesses, and how the characterization of that need is unmet in the community by existing organizations, some of which you're already familiar with.
Well, getting back to the term grassroots, we've been spending a lot of time knocking on doors, one-on-one, talking to local small businesses, and those members who have signed up and joined have specific concerns. Example, in the Heights, there's a small area where there's a brand new business opening, just opened. There's two smaller fledgling businesses. A fourth one is remodeling and about to open, and there's a building next to that one where someone's going to come in. And their issue is, in one word, parking.
Parking.
So
right, okay.
That the owner of two of those businesses joined, and we expect the third one of those businesses to join, and probably the others, because we said, well, we'll take your issue to those appropriate to address it, whether it's town elected officials, whether it's a landlord. And so when you offer to do something like that for someone who's struggling to make his business go, he doesn't need a lawyer, he doesn't need an accountant, he needs no one else but the YSBA. Call him. We'll match him up to somebody.
Right.
And we'll go. We've gone to see. I have a number of advisory board members at this point, and we'll go together to see that business person or business.
So you're uniquely qualified to do that by your experience. Is that something that the Yorktown Chamber of Commerce does not do?
We didn't really. I can't answer that.
They do.
I'm sure they do things, and I think this question was asked last week or just in passing with someone. We didn't put this together because we identified these weak points on this organization or that. We just had this feeling that there was this need out there and it wasn't being met. We got that feedback from our initial contacts, and we've been feeding on that ever since.
I think the difference is it's a different scale. I mean, the chamber, in fact, is very actively involved with that type of thing and is bringing in May, and people can look it up, to town hall.
The county economic
relief, you might call it, or subsidization for local businesses from the county level with Jim Coleman and the industry. They're involved. So I think it's a matter of scale.
Right.
And I think what you're saying, Bob, with YSBA is you're trying to drill down to maybe, you know, help some of the people who, you know, as the expression goes, fall through the cracks. Or,
right.
And it seems like you're functioning also as like a lobbyist, right, yeah. in a way.
Well,
you know, in terms of interfacing with the government and yeah. helping them.
We say we're advisors, advocates, and mentors. And
right.
I think, yeah, you know, you had okay. on your sheet here, SCORE. I got my start in White Plains when I left right. my second corporate job in 95. The first thing I did was I went to sign up for unemployment, and there was a program that was then just being started, which said if you would start a business or promise to start a business, we won't require you to go out interviewing. We'll let you collect unemployment for 6 months, but you have to promise to start a business. I went right out, filed my subchapter S corporation, and started Robert F. Giordano Associates, an IT consulting company. So then I find myself in White Plains at the Eastview Technology Center, and what do I do?
Right.
I've been in a corporate job. I'm ready for a paycheck, and there isn't one coming down the road anytime soon. So I had to.
Right.
I went to SCORE, and I
right.
said, "Here's what I did. Here's what I know. What do I need to do?" So I mean, these guys are—they stay whatever it stands for: senior core executive.
You know, something like that. They're basically retired executives.
They're
right?
veteran executives that have a lot of experience
right.
in business. So, where's your business plan? I said, what business plan? You know.
Right.
So I understand that.
And they volunteer their time. There's no charge
right.
for it.
And they actually get funded. They're a non-for-profit organization. They get funding from the SBA to run some of these programs.
Right.
As a matter of fact, I met with them recently, and we're talking about what the needs are for our members in the YSBA and how we could work together to effectively, you know, use their skill set.
Right.
So,
well, so I know they meet, speaking of that, they meet with businesses who call them up and set an appointment at the chamber, right, on Fridays.
Yes.
Right, they have sessions on Friday. If you call them up
right.
and say, I'd like to meet with you, they'll meet with you and
exactly.
help you out. So that's good, too.
So let's pause for a moment to emphasize the distinguishing characteristics which we seem to use the word need to describe, and that is as it's advisor,
advocate, and mentor.
Advisor, advocate, and mentor. Okay, great. So you talked a little bit about the advocate. You would represent them in town meetings and by petition to discuss the needs that these local small businesses have. What is the extent of your advisorship to businesses? And where we're going here is if there's an audience out there that's listening to this show and they're asking, why do I join this organization? You're not really about the membership so much as you are about reaching out to provide assistance to small businesses and communities.
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct. So your question is on
to the extent of the advisorship.
The advisory and mentoring portion of what
yeah.
I said.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I had an experience with a local business in knocking on their doors, and I went in with some, if I say what it was, then you'll know who it was, and I don't want to, you know, let it out. But I went in with four widgets, and I wanted four new ones. And the owner said, I only have three. So what, I don't need them right now. So when you get the fourth one, I'll come in and get them all. He said, I don't know when I'll get them, so I'll give you the three that I can, and you should go there. There was his competitor. That is basic 101. You're telling me, who a client of yours who came for a need that you could fulfill, and you tell me you can only do three out of the four things I need today, and you're not willing to tell me to come back tomorrow or go to bat for me to get that fourth thing, and you created a problem for yourself in telling me to go to one of your competitors to get it. So there's an advisory type of thing that we're talking about. Common sense. And you know what? We've seen businesses come and go all over the hamlets, the five of them.
Right.
This one opens and say, you know, how many more ice cream shops do we need?
Right, exactly. Yeah.
I mean, you know, I wish there was someone like me and the YSBA around when I started out, because people don't really, they have a pile of money, whether it's hard-earned or handed to them. They decide that's the corner I want to open, where I want to go, and this is what I want to do. There's no marketing.
Regardless of market demand
there's or nothing.
Market research or anything like that.
Yeah, we're coming up behind them to say, okay, you're open. You may have some problems. You want to talk to us?
Right.
You want to, I mean, open up your jacket and let us inside, and we'll tell you frankly, candidly, what we see.
Yeah. Right. Well, this is a good point because what you're providing in this particular regard is something that that for-profit businesses tend to do for the same audience if that's their focus or target audience. So companies like Chase Media Group or C Communications or any number of others will do that sort of thing. But the customer feels more comfortable when it is someone who is not trying to sell them something.
A neutral third.
Taking that advice and that direction and that mentorship than from an organization that is positioned to help them through the use of their products.
Correct.
So not that one is better than the other, but it's more comfortable for the small business advocate and owner. And so that advocacy is more friendly, it becomes a little bit more credible and easier to access. And that's what they need. They need those things, right?
So that
And that's not something typically, don't know exactly if the Yorktown Chamber is providing that, but chambers in general do not provide that level of, that resolute level of assistance, of advice, of going to bat for, of mentorship.
Right.
Those things tend not to exist here. They tend to be like our neighborhoods across America that have become rather isolated within their own bubble, so to speak. And we stopped paying attention to who our neighbors are and their particular needs.
Yeah.
This is quite the opposite. This is rebuilding the sense of neighborhood in the commercial community. And that's an extraordinary thing to do.
Yeah.
And it's something that many companies attempt to do, and without describing all of those ways, but are constrained by the fact that they also have a product to sell.
Yeah, you know what? I think our first few members, when we went back to them to tell them that we heard what your concerns were and we wanted to have a discussion, they're like, you really meant what you said? And, you know, they're actually, you know, it's almost like they're waiting for you to pull out an invoice or a contract sign here. And they, no, you joined. We're here to help you. And that's what we said we were going to do, and that's what we're going to do. But you're right. My experience at the chamber early on when we set up some of the administrative functions was, you know, you call up and you say you need a plumber. So who's our plumber? And at the time, the office was saying, well, the first plumber on the list is Bruce and Frank's of plumbing. And we discovered through trial and error that, you know, it's unfair to the guy who's second and third on the list, and we don't want to be the one who decides who you call. But here's the process became, here's the five plumbers who are members, call them. No, not getting into what your plumbing issue is, you know, did you try plunging the toilet if it's clogged? I mean, you have a plunger before you call a plumber who's going to charge you $125 an hour. So that's a kind of...
But I think it's sort of an additive situation where, like, you know, with what Frank was talking about, I mean, that's what the Yorktown Chamber is doing with SCORE. So what they've done is created this strategic alliance with SCORE so that, you know, when businesses of any size who belong to the chamber need help, they'll call SCORE as a partner of the chamber,
right?
And then they meet at the chamber's office, and you're doing more of that. So to me, it's like, it seems the more services, local services that are available to businesses, the more businesses will benefit from it and thrive from it, and you know, and that type of thing. We should talk about, Bob. How many members do you have? Currently?
Well, you know what? We're just embarking, as you know, on our design of the website. We have set goals, which I'm not at this point going to divulge, but we're on target, and we're probably going to make once the website is built, we have the numbers that we would like to see. That will be divulged at that. So we have two goals. We have a July and a year-end goal, and we think that we're going to make both of them, and I think everyone's going to be surprised at the number of businesses that are signing up. I mean, just a few success stories that have gotten, it's word of mouth at this point, and you guys know how important word of mouth is. When you solve somebody's problem and you did it because they're a member of an organization and they tell someone else the phone, I mean, I got two memberships yesterday in the mail that I merely knocked on their door, explained what we were, here's the presentation material to the town board we did, and they must have read some of the things that were in the press and never even called me, just sent the application in with a check. So
yeah, that's
pretty good stuff,
yeah.
I think.
And also, I know you've had at least one or more of these, and we should talk about cash mob events.
Yeah.
So why don't you talk about what those sure. are and how they work?
Well, if you do a search on cash mobs, and some people basically misuse the term flash mobs because they're two different things.
Mm-hmm.
But a flash mob is, this day and age, everyone has a cell phone and some gizmo,
right.
and suddenly I call Frank and Frank calls Bruce and we're going to meet on the corner of Grape Street and Vine and we're going to have a dance jam. No,
mm-hmm.
and it just goes. It goes out. It goes out.
Scare people away.
No, but this is what happens. That's
yeah.
a flash.
Right, I mean, it's a flash.
The things
well,
that
yeah.
go on Grand Central right. Station. All of a sudden, 200 people show up.
Right. Yes.
And all of a sudden, right. 3 o'clock, they all froze.
Right.
And everybody's walking around the Grand Central. What the hell? What's going on here?
Yeah.
You know. So forget about the flash mob. The cash mob. It's intended to help local. Well, I shouldn't say just local. It's intended to get a group of people to a business who might not otherwise go there for a purpose to say, we're going to meet at, we had a several events, 5 or 6 of them last year for Smart Growth that I ran. It actually took me 3 or 4 months to get the board. Like everyone's, what's a cash mob?
Mm-hmm.
Why are we doing this?
Mm-hmm.
What we did, I think our first one was at Kirby's. All right, so Kirby's is a gem of a place. It's got great barbecue.
Right.
It's got huge, comfortable seating area. So we went to them and we said, what could we do to bring some people into your business who may never go there, might never come? He said, for $10, I'll let people taste everything on my menu. So he put it up on the bar, and yeah. 40 or 50 people showed up. So he recouped his cost for the food probably, but more importantly, he probably got 5 or 10 steady customers out of it.
Yeah, that's right.
Right?
Yeah,
so, sure. And the more recent one was at the Yorktown Deli, and they joined. One of my advisor board members went in there and said, Bob, they just opened up. They're not even there for a month or two.
Right.
They seem interested, went talked to him and said, you got an issue here. The issue is parking. He said, I know, we're trying to address that because
right.
at lunchtime it gets very crowded.
Yeah.
So we did a cash mob there. And again, he put up a spread that you wouldn't believe from 9 until 1 on a Sunday. Michael Grace was there, Vishnu
town
came.
Supervisor.
Right, and it was
right.
it was just fantastic. Yeah. Now again, for the couple of dollars that he spent to put that out,
he got his return.
If
yeah.
he gets right. 10 steady yeah. people there for breakfast
well
every day,
yep.
that spend
yep.
$5, just think of
right.
it. So,
and we're going to have to wrap it up now,
okay.
Bob. So,
okay.
But no, that we're, you know, best of luck, obviously, with the
Thank
new
you.
Organization.
Thank you.
Bob Giordano, founder of Yorktown Small Business Association. And thank you for watching Frank Talks with Bruce the Blog. And remember, when Bruce the Blog listens, people talk. Thank you. Thank you.